review, discuss, and set goals from. I'd like to lay out a little bit of the ground rules for the use of the facility. The only thing that we've observed for the use of the county is this area right here. There are two restrooms over to the left and here in the back, right that are for our use. And I do have some coffee in the room and some snacks and later. So I'd like to begin with the audit report. And Henderson Robin and John are the auditors that you have selected. With us this morning, we have Mr. Mark Rogers and Mr. Scott Simpson. Scott is the primary auditor and lead auditor for this review this year. Mark has been the principal for Manhattan years back and forth with him. And I'd like to turn this over to them. And we do have financial report in front of you, as well as letters provided by Henderson Drive. So, Mark, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. I can't imagine any better way to start off your 2 days than with the audit report. This audit is for June 30th, 2014. So, it's about 7 months ago. I was sitting here talking to Stephanie and telling her this audit of financial statements is 153 pages long. If you look at GE, you know, financial statements probably 15 pages. So that gives you a little comparison with what accounting versus an industry is. It's pretty complicated, pretty diverse in all the operations that you do. Every year I prepare a little summary, and it starts out with a honorable chairman and distinguished member of the commission. This is a little synopsis. What I'm going to really be talking about is on page 3, 3, 4, 5. Your financial statements are broken up into, let me go with the back of the middle, back into the general fund is the catch-all. So if it doesn't fall into any other group, it goes to the general fund. So we'll go over the general fund, and then we'll go over special revenue. Special revenue is anything that has, basically what it says. Special revenue, tax, some fees, anything that's specifically for you got to spend on a certain level. Capital projects is very similar to that, but it's to build capital projects. Most of your SPLOS goes through there, some public roads, initial building went through there. So that's the capital projects. Capital projects and the SPLOS are very similar. They have their own little set. Then we get over to proprietary funds. Proprietary funds operate like a business. The water, sewer, the landfill, special lighting, those have assess fees on those. You expect to generate enough fees to offset your capital expenses, all the expenses that you've got associated with that project. You expect to get reimbursed. The internal service funds, they operate like enterprise funds, but they're only for the use of the county. So they don't sell to outside, you don't have any customers. The only customer is the county. Okay. So We'll start on page 3, which is the general fund. For the year 2014, total taxes actual were $41,888,000. That compares to the budget of $41,860,000. And 2013 number, $41,855,000. So you can see that your taxes are pretty consistent. Skip on down to charges for service. Charges for service 2014 were $3,582,000 compared to budget $3,630,000 compared to 2013 actual was $3,747,000. Fines and forfeitures 2014 $1,757,000 compared to budget $1,755,000 compared to the prior year $1,793,000. That brings our total revenue for 2014 at $47,496,000 compared to budget of $47,772,000. And this compares to 2013 of $46,943,000. Any questions so far? This is kind of interactive thing.
Yeah, this is your opportunity as opposed to you to ask several questions related to the finances that you've spoken to me in more steadily. Here is your opportunity to ask anything you want, obviously, to all of us.
Yeah, sir, let me add that real quick. As Joe said, this is your opportunity. This gives us the opportunity here to be able to get into more depth of the questions, its answers, and have more time than we typically want to have at a meeting. So feel free to speak up.
I just like 40% of the budget went towards public safety.
That's right.
42%. And that would be the Sheriff's Department.
That would be the Sheriff's Department and
too far ahead of this presentation as we kind of move along and you've got questions, then we'll be able to everybody stay on track and stay on track.
What all is included in the charges for services? Is that sewer and water?
This is the downlines.
Okay, it's the catch all.
So, charges for service, those are the things like prisoner housing.
Right.
All right, so that makes up our revenue. We'll go over the expenditures now. The general fund, the general government, the 2014 actual was $16,688,000 compared to budget of $16,788,000 compared to 2013 actual of $15,788,000. Public safety was $19,921,000. Budgeted was $19,928,000. 2013 was $19,118,000. Public works was $4,706,000 compared to budget $4,708,000 compared to 13 $4,496,000. Culture and recreation, that includes the park and rec. We collect those taxes and then remit them straight to parks and rec department. So that was $4,681,000 compared to $4,682,000 budgeted, compared to $4,577,000 in 2013. The same way with housing and development and industrial authority, we collect those taxes and remit them straight to the industrial authority. That total was $2,947,000 compared to budgeted $3,045,000 compared to 2013, $2,019,000. So our total expenditures for general fund were $49,635,000 compared to budget $49,767,000 and the previous year end was $47,570,000. Total change in fund balance for the year was a negative $1,779,000 compared to budget $1,936,000 compared to previous year of negative $668,000. The majority of the difference in 2013 expenditures versus 2014 was the health care costs. I think that was, I know we talked about it several times when I came, and it just seems to be an ever increasing problem. I was in a meeting the other day with a city, and they asked me, did I have a silver bullet for that? You know, did I have the answer? I did not have an answer. Believe me, our premiums at our office went up 22%.
Now, are you talking about the jail medical costs?
No, this is for the employees.
So health and welfare on here?
No, it actually, there's no specific place. It's included in each one of these line items.
So what does health and welfare cover?
Health and welfare is your contributions to public health, mental health, defects, and the extension service.
If you want more detail on these, we can look on page 74 of the financial statements. And they break these numbers down by the original budget, the final budget, the actual, and the variance to budget.
This is in reference to the health care costs. This is something that I think I mentioned to several of you in general discussions as an item of concern. I know the chairman and I have discussed it throughout the year. Stephanie and I have had lengthy discussions along with Harrison. One of the items that you need to be aware of that is reflected in this 1.7 is, if y'all recall, we changed providers last year, and we had been using group resources, and we went to Paragon. Well, part of that change resulted in a like 4 months approximately of payouts that when you add those in, that increases number. It's something that we have tried to address, and Harrison may make some comments on it later. You will hear more about it as we go into the budget in the coming months as to our ideas in addressing this. Those of you who have been here are aware that we implemented our wellness program a number of years ago. That wellness program is beginning to pay dividends. The main thing that we see right now, the dividend, is in the improvement of, I guess, maybe baby steps in the health care and the acknowledgement of employees on what they need to do related to hypertension and blood pressure, et cetera, et cetera. So hopefully, in the game plan has been all along, after about a 4 to 5 year experience of the wellness program, we anticipate being able to see some dollar changes. So I'm saying that what we've seen so far is not dollar related, but it is a, as Mark said, it's a problem that's not unique to Lowndes County. It's common in every organization. I'm sure each of you and your businesses and in those affiliations that you have are aware of these continuing costs. Ours is magnified, as Mark has already said, because of our numbers and so forth. We also, like everybody else, have families, associated spouses, children, et cetera, et cetera. And not like any other group or organization, but this problem, this issue, is a growing concern from a financial standpoint and how we continue to modify our reaction in dealing with the needs of our employees and balancing that with the cost associated and the impact it has on the taxpayers. Again, Harrison will get a little deeper into it now. When his term comes, but it is, just to underline Mark's comments, it is a problem that we are aware of. It is something that we will continue to work on. And those of you that have been here a little while, it is not news to you. The numbers may be, but the issue itself.
But the anticipated cost for next year shouldn't go up because of the payout.
Right. That should not be an issue. Yep. Now, continued increase in health care costs and those other items that we deal
hopefully
with.
Hopefully will offset and maybe still keep us.
Well, we don't know. We still will probably have to deal with an increase anyway from the provider. Just the rate, just the
administrative.
Yeah, the administrative stuff.
Your goal is to flatten your trend.
Right.
So since we're only starting the third year of our wellness plan, we're still experiencing in these numbers what you see with the onset of any wellness plan, in that everyone goes to the doctor because now they're required to. Our catastrophic claims are what's eating through this number largely. So if you want to create a culture of a healthy environment, it helps with productivity and people not being able to work. But so you want to pay those small maintenance, take care of yourself, go to the doctor every year. So some of this increase has been, we had a huge amount of folks who weren't doing that, who now currently are.
And plus, I think that now we got that ideal doctor option.
Yes.
Hope to save money, maybe.
So there are things, tweaks, and adjustments that we anticipate giving more details on. But to say we hope that it will be better this year, yes, we certainly hope. But we also are aware that this is a significant issue, that one little tweak or one little change or one little adjustment in and of itself is not going to turn these numbers from a deficit.
It's an issue as a whole that we, as we move forward in the budgeting process, it's going to be an issue that's going to have to be addressed through that process and how that increases will be.
Is there any incentive to get employees to get on
Yes, as a matter of fact, one of the things that we began this wellness program was that it would not be punitive in that, for instance, we would set a rate. Those individuals who participated and were involved in the wellness program would receive a reduction in their premium charge and send it to participate. And after that first year, we had a number of employees and individuals that really saw the significant difference and began to participate. As a matter of fact, I think the numbers of participants versus non-participants after the first year totally reversed. And we increased, and we continue to see that, as Paige said. So that's why we knew that it was not going to be a 1 year, 2 year, even 3 year, but a 5 year commitment to this wellness program to see that we would hopefully have those changes in place.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Out of respect for Mark's time, though, we'll be able to talk further about this later.
During the budget, you're going to have more time to talk about this and probably the block.
And our research worker is tracking our trends to the max. So there'll be a lot more information that you guys get related to that. And HR is focusing their education related to when you should go to the emergency room, when you should go to the doctor.
That's how we made it happen.
Yes. In accordance with those trends.
Quick question on some of those. So basically you're saying, as we look at these other departments, we see increases. A lot of large contributors is going to be the healthcare versus the 1.7 just being, a total loss.
I said the insurance, as Mark indicated, is charged to each department. So there's not a separate line item that's earmarked in healthcare only.
And we'll be able to clarify some of that when we get into the internal service fund, because it does have, it will show you what the total expenses for health care was, and then I'll tell you what the number was last year. So that'll give you kind of indication of where that fund was. Any additional questions on the general fund before we move on to the special revenue funds. This includes special services from the commissary, seizures, hotel motel tax, intergovernmental grants, jail operations, drug abuse, E911, and victim assistant and law library. The total revenues for 2014 were $9,182,000 compared to $9,781,000 in the previous year. Expenditures were $9,066,000 compared to $10,103,000 previous year. Our revenues over expenditures total was $511,000 compared to $176,000 in the previous year. Obviously, the majority of the revenue expenses were in special services, and 911, those made up the majority of the revenue and expenses for the year. Special services ended with revenues over expenses of $446,000. The E911 ended with loss of probably $30,000 for the year. Intergovernmental grants, that's a break even. You get the money in, you spend it out. So that is designed for a break even type deal. Any questions on special revenue?
Did you have any highlighters with E911?
I think that's pretty well in line with last year. The county transfers money in there to offset the additional expenses that they incur over the income they receive.
Stephanie, how many contributors to special services?
Special services are all your inherent, your incorporated revenues, and there's expenditure for compensation incorporated services. So that's where your alcohol licenses, the tax on alcohol, your insurance premium tax, those things that, those things are all in place on your incorporated.
And this, landfill fees?
Those are your solid waste fees.
Yes, I think it was special services.
That goes in the landfill fund, which is under your enterprise.
Any other questions?
All right, so we got down to capital projects. The capital projects, 2014 total revenue of $21,632,000 compared to $22,658,000 previous year. Expenditures were $23,184,000 compared to $19,440,000 previous year. Your revenues under expenditures were $1,633,000 this year. Last year was revenue over expenditures of $3,218,000. Majority of the revenues and expenses in this are from the squalls. You can see that we ended up old squalls last year, mid-year, and you started a new one this year. So you can see that $10 million was in the squall 6, and $10 million was in the squall 7. And so if you look at those two numbers, you can see that your expenses in Squall 6 were greater than your revenue, and your expenses in Squall 7 were less than your revenues, because that you're getting the money first, and then you spend it out. So that Squall 6 still has $2,551,000 left in it, and so that'll start going down. Your revenue source will be zero next year, but those expenses will continue. The same way with Squall 5, you can see that the revenues are equitable and your expenditures are $756,000. So that number will continue to go down. So those ebb and flow by the number. Additional questions on capital? Flip over to the next page. These are your proprietary funds. These are your services to outside people. You have customers that put you onto your water system, your landfill is the tax. There used to be an additional one for the sanitation, and it closed last year, year before last.
Year before.
Yeah, year before. So, and then special lighting. So, your total revenues for these funds were $5,968,000 compared to $5,916,000 the previous year. Your expenses were $4,578,000 compared to $5,300,000 the previous year. Your change in net position was $776,000 for 2014, and in 2013 it was a negative $186,000. So, like I said, the majority of them, the expenses and the revenues come from the water sewer. Water sewer ended with $630,000
net income. Any questions?
And so the special tax line is where we kind of take a hit?
Yes, and you remember, Commissioner, we began the process, and Jason had been before you on the note,
changes that we're making to try to rectify those differences in the charges, and I think we have made significant improvement in that area.
Yes.
And
over the last 10 years.
Jason and I worked on an audit of the program, and I think we covered about half of the deficits in the amounts. Then we brought before you some recommendations to come before you again with some changes on the trades perhaps.
And this was intended to be done, if you remember, in a step process, so that it was not such an overall dramatic impact on the citizens, that we moved along, but we made these charges as fair and equitable to all parties as possible without it being that sudden and such a tremendous difference at one time.
What is the operating revenue in landfill?
That's just all of us, basically.
That's for the year. And operating expenses, you said, was flat, too?
That's your contribution to KOEB and also the operating or the cost for the methane monitoring and keeping that site cleaned up.
All right, so we'll move on to the internal service funds. Internal service fund is made up of equipment fund, health insurance, workers' comp, and fleet management. Total revenue for 2014 was $9,965,000 compared to $9,089,000 in 2013. Operating expenses were $10,686,000 compared to $9,441,000 previous year. The net income loss 2014 had a loss of $723,000 compared to a loss of $355,000 previous year. The health insurance is the largest fund in this. Our operating revenues were $6,369,000. The expenses were $6,364,000 to have this account break even at $5,000 per year. The operating expenses of $6,364,000 14 compared to 2013 was $5,429,000. So that's an increase of $934,000 this year.
Excuse me, Joe. If I'm not mistaken, one of the individuals that was ill in his past, to my understanding, that spent a great deal of money on the two right.
Yes, obviously every year we've had three or four, maybe five cases of catastrophic loss.
Keep them away from the city of the past.
Mark?
The fleet manager, operating revenues and operating expenses.
Right.
Is that always the case? Is that typically the case? I mean, it looks like all of your loss really came from
that's right.
That one area.
Right. And I believe that was by design this year, because what you're trying to do is you're just trying to break even on those. You're just trying to allocate out. And you see that in previous years, and you look at our net position at the end of the year, was -$11,000. So it was to bring that down to a true break even. At that point in time. So we had basically made income in the previous years. We brought that down to more of a break-even type deal overall.
But next year, or this year coming up, we're looking at having to have basically another
depreciation value. The maintenance cost of them, but.
So this is depreciation value that we're looking at as well?
Well, it does have.
But it does include depreciation for $400,000 for depreciation.
How much is it?
It's over $400,000.
It's about $400,000
for
depreciation.
From prior vehicles that were bought out, I suppose.
Any questions?
We appreciate the opportunity, certainly. Thank you very much for your time.
Well, absolutely. We appreciate it.
You know, we appreciate it.
Before you mark, from your review, could you give the commission an idea of the financial snapshot that you took, the condition of the county, and the condition of from a financial standpoint?
Right. Our grade.
A grade?
Well, this is my, you know, we've incurred in the general fund a loss the last 2 years. And we know where most of that is attributed to. But we do have a fund balance that offset, you know, we've been able to take those hits. There's some city and counties that have not been able to weather these type of issues. So in overall, you know, are we in better shape than we were last year? Probably not. Are we in better shape than a lot of cities and counties? Absolutely. A lot of them.
What one concept that those of you that are new will hear more about in the budget process is that, contrary to some governments, when we balance the budget and when we submit to you a balanced budget, we do not anticipate balancing that budget from fund balance. We're, in simple terms, we are not balancing it by pulling money out of your savings. What we do is we anticipate those revenues, we anticipate those expenditures, submit those to you, you tell us what they are, what we do with those. And then, if there is, in fact, a deficit that we have to deal with, as we have for the last 2 years, we have the availability of those fund balances. Now, you know that we have a policy, most of you know that we have a policy, to maintain 120 days operating expense. We have been able to do that. We have fluctuated sometimes slightly below that, sometimes above that, but that has been our policy. That is what we strive for. That is why, to the chagrin of the number of offices and departments, Stephanie and I are extremely hard in dealing with these finances, because we have to be the person who says yes and no based on what you have said as a budget and those expenditures. So we do not, so that we do not get into a situation where we're like what Mark has described, balancing our budget on the front end as opposed to the back. Is that fair to say?
And one other thing, you know, that health care, that fund is sitting over there. And y'all absorb that whole loss. I've got some city and counties that don't absorb that. You know, they're sitting with an unfunded liability sitting over there that they're not recognizing, which is unfair to the public, you know, that they don't say, yeah, you know, their general fund looks like they broke even or made a little money or whatever, but they have this unfunded liability over here that they're not recognizing. Now, at some point in time, that's going to come home to roost.
I'd like to ask, and of course, Mr. Rogers and Mr. Simpson is probably more specific to Mr. Simpson since he was involved in the whole process. With the auditor, from an auditor standpoint, first off, we have an award-winning finance department from the way that they do their presentations and overall finances. My question to you is, doing the audit, did you find anything in the audit as far as any deficiencies, anything, any recommendations that would need to be made that would kind of help and enhance what is currently being done?
There were no deficiencies in the audit, and this second letter actually references that.
Okay.
This is the letter to governance. And we had no deficiencies, and there were no, you know, it also references that there were any difficulties encountered or anything like that, and there were none. You know, it also references the estimates that were significant in the financials. So you can see those, you know, some of those are lives, capital assets, medical claims, which is an estimate every year. So those are the significant, if you read through that, it may give you an idea of what went into that. But as far as deficiencies or difficulties, we did not encounter any of that.
As a matter of procedures, we have an office that is available to our firm. They come in, it's theirs, when Harrison's not using it.
They take over
that process. All of the staff is instructed, whatever the auditors need, make that available, whether it's from Paige's office through any of the departments, through the finance offices as well, through Harrison. I would say that the audit report would be more difficult for y'all if it were not for Harrison doing a good bit of legwork throughout the year. So when you're looking at those expenses later on in the budget, be aware that those monies could easily be assessed by an audit firm for the extra work that has to be done that Harrison does, would have to do and does for the audit, but also does as a benefit to the finance department, that we would have to have a much larger finance office if it were not for those.
Yeah, it significantly cuts down the work we have.
Well, from my standpoint, I have absolutely no objection to as many eyes as possible looking at it from a professional standpoint. You know, and again, if Steph was here, and I'd say whether Steph was here or not, I've never seen anything other than the top of the line professionalism out of our finance department, and that's the reason I just posed the question to you as the professional from the public meeting to confirm that we that everything is being done as it should be according to protocol and according to good accounting principles.
Absolutely.
And one final comment. In discussing, Mark alluded to this earlier, in discussing the finances, and you say, we'd like this simplified. As simple as possible. Are we doing okay or are we not doing okay? It's very difficult to take the complexity of accounting, governmental accounting, and boil it down to that. We can do it, but it's not giving you all the details and everything. So he's already told you how complex it is and governmental accounting requirements that these guys have to continue to go off every year or almost every year for additional training and certification just to be able to do governmental accounting, because as all of you have come in and said, I understand accounting a little bit for my business. I think I can pick this up only
to a few days into it to be scratching your head saying, this makes absolutely no sense in the world. Why are you doing this? Well, it's because that's the requirements that are placed on this. So that's why it is as complex as it is.
Sure. Okay. Thank you all very much. Yeah. Thank you very much for your time. Appreciate your hard work.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Great presentation. Okay, we'll move.